This program is brought to you by Emory University.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our second Grand Rounds lecture. Hope everybody had a nice weekend and fall is here. I have had the wonderful privilege of introducing Dr. Wenger several times during this series. And thank you again, Dr. Wenger, for volunteering, because I always appreciate that when somebody says, we'll take a spot. Dr. Wenger continues to inspire us all with her tremendous drive and tireless efforts to educate us in all the areas that are that she's well known for and passionate about, are women's heart disease, cardiovascular prevention, geriatrics, cardiology, and contemporary cardiac care. She has published over 1,700 articles, and I'm sure that at the end of this hour, there'll be another publication with Dr. Wenger's name on it that'll come out. So it just, just keeps going. She's received numerous awards, and I will highlight the few in the past couple of years. She's achieved received Lifetime Achievement Award from the ACC last year, and also the World Heart Federation. The American Society of Preventive Cardiology has honored a lectureship named after Dr. Wenger, where a distinguished speaker, a lecture that focuses on women and heart disease. And also the American Heart Association has an annual award for best scientific publication named after Dr. Wenger for a publication in cardiovascular disease in women. So thank you, Dr. Wenger, for taking the time this morning to update us on the 2023 ESC guidelines for the management of ACS. This is hot off the press since ESC just happened a couple of weeks ago, and Dr. Wenger will tell us what's new and what we need to know. Thanks so much for being here in person today to present.
Good morning, and this morning, we'll be talking about the 2023 ESC guidelines for the management of acute coronary syndromes. These are my disclosures and they do not relate to the presentation. But as you know, the ESC released these guidelines just a few weeks ago. And over the past 2 years, it has been my pleasure to work with some very exciting European colleagues on the development of these guidelines. You will remember that in the past, we had separate guidelines on unstable angina, on NSTEMI, on STEMI, on secondary prevention. And as we met as a task force and writing group, we realized that this was really a continuum. And we decided that we would do one guideline on the management of acute coronary syndromes. We worked for 2 years during the pandemic. Most of our meetings, and we worked in groups, most of our meetings were on Zoom. And many of you know that the headquarters of ESC are in Paris. So with Paris meeting time, I spent a great deal of Zoom time between 1 and 2 a.m. for weeks on end, but I thought it was worth it. Now, what I want to share with you is conceptually how we've put this together. And what I want to do is to outline the algorithms that we put together and the pathways that we put together for the various components of the acute coronary syndromes. Now, ACS obviously is a spectrum. It starts with unstable angina, goes on to NSTEMI and STEMI. For the guideline, we use the data from 936 publications and ended up with a 107-page document that you can read at your leisure. I will highlight for you some of the areas I think are most important. But what we chose to do was to address comprehensive patient management from admission to long-term care. And we did something else that was interesting. We had a patient as a member of the task force, and Mary Galbraith provided very important patient perspectives that are included in the guideline. Now, the conceptual approach goes something like this, and it's what you should be thinking of. Think ACS, and I'll tell you in a moment what that abbreviation will translate into at the initial assessment. Think about invasive management. Think about antithrombotic therapy. Think about revascularization, and think about secondary prevention. And that's essentially the pathway that I will follow this morning. We also had a section on gaps in evidence, and that essentially gives you a research agenda for the future. Now, remember that the presentation is typically chest pain or pressure, and therefore we emphasize some of the variables in this. About 80% of both women and men with an ACS will present with chest pain or pressure. But this is not the classic Hollywood heart attack with sudden chest pain and collapse. There are very often many other symptoms: diaphoresis, indigestion, epigastric pain, shoulder, arm, neck pain, and those are common in both women and men who present to us with an acute coronary syndrome. But important for us to recognize is that some symptoms may be far more common in women with an acute coronary syndrome, and they include dizziness, syncope, nausea, vomiting, jaw and neck pain, shortness of breath, pain between the shoulder blades, palpitations, sudden fatigue. And as I've told my colleagues in the emergency room, when a woman comes in with acute symptoms, anywhere between the umbilicus and the jawbone, think the possibility of acute coronary syndrome. Now, what about this ACS? What should be your orientation for these patients? A, is the ECG abnormal? So you perform an ECG both to assess for evidence of ischemia and to look for other abnormalities. C, what is the clinical context? Consider the clinical context and anything else that is available about the patient. And S, for stability, examine the patient to see if the patient is clinically and vitally stable. Tremendous difference between the approach to the patient who is stable and who is unstable. Now, ACS is a spectrum, and it's a spectrum of clinical presentation, of ECG, and it in the symptom presentation, the patient may have had pain, but may have few or no symptoms at presentation. There may be increasing chest pain, there may be persistent chest pain, or indeed the patient may have cardiogenic shock or acute heart failure, or even cardiac arrest. The ECG may be normal. There may be ST segment depression. ST segment elevation makes it easy. STEMIs are easier to recognize than any of the others, but there also may be malignant arrhythmias. And when you see this, your working diagnosis is either a non-ST elevation ACS or a STEMI. And here is where the laboratory data come in. If there is no elevation of the high sensitivity troponin, this becomes unstable angina. But a rise and fall are seen both with NSTEMI and STEMI. And it is the ECG here that helps you differentiate. Now let's look at the triage and see what is it that we do and how do we investigate the patient. So here is your patient with chest symptoms. You do an ECG initially, a physical exam, a clinical history, vital signs, and get the high sensitivity troponin. As I've said before, the working diagnosis of STEMI is easy. That ST elevation really helps you. And essentially, what you think about once you see that ECG is, should the patient go for immediate PCI? What about the antithrombotic therapy? But remember, many patients present to settings where the availability of PCI is not immediate. And for those patients, the approach is fibrinolysis. Non-ST elevation is really more complex. And here we will have some patients with very high risk features, and I'll go into those in a moment, or not very high risk features. Typically, the high risk feature patient, and I'll outline for you those variables, will have ECG abnormalities. And for those patients with very high risk, it's essentially immediate PCI with antithrombotic therapy. If there are not very high risk features, then the angiography is not as immediate, but we probably should consider it if there are any high risk features, not very high risk features, within the first 24 hours, and that's PCI plus the antithrombotic therapy. Now, there may be other investigations, and I'll show you where those might fit in, echocardiography, intravascular imaging, following the course of the high sensitivity troponin, and serial monitoring of the ECG. And then the final management goes through pathways that we will explore later on in the talk. The patient may go for PCI or CABG. There is definite long-term medical therapy. There are lifestyle measures. We specifically added in separately smoking cessation because of the importance of that as a lifestyle measure. Now let's look first at the patient with STEMI. So here we have the patient with pain, we have the ST elevation on the ECG, and there is a difference with the way the patients present. The patients may self-present to the hospital, or they may come with emergency medical services. Now, if the patient with a STEMI comes to a center where PCI is available, then obviously the goal is to do the PCI within ideally 60 minutes. Now, if the patient comes with EMS, they may come to a non-PCI center, or the ambulance may take them to the PCI center. In a non-PCI center, if the patient can be transferred to a PCI center within 90 minutes, that is the preferable goal. If not, then it is fibrinolysis and transfer to a PCI center. Now, because the total ischemic time is so important, we added this to our graphics. And here we talk about the total ischemic time, and you have to realize what contributes to it, because if the total ischemic time is excess, there are different ways in which you can correct it. In orange, you see the patient delay, and that is in the orange. But in addition to the patient delay to reperfusion, there is a system delay. And the system delays are our responsibility to correct. If the patient calls the EMS, there is the patient delay in calling, there is the delay in EMS, and then the very complex system delay that may vary from one community to the next. Now, let's see what is it that we do for the patient with NSTEMI, because as I've said, the NSTEMI patients are really more variable and more complex. So suspected NSTEMI without an indication for immediate angiography, meaning no very high risk characteristics. You really want the troponin levels at presentation and then at 1 to 2 hours. If that troponin is very low or normal, it is unlikely to be an NSTEMI. The patient likely has unstable angina, and there is a rule-out pathway. If the patient has a high initial troponin, and if it increases, then that becomes the rule-in pathway. And patients don't know they're supposed to go into either of those two boxes. So there are some where the management can be determined based on serial troponin levels and the clinical situation. And that is, those are probably the most complex patients in terms of decision-making. Now let's look at how you select invasive strategy and reperfusion therapy in the patient with a non-ST elevation ACS. Here you have the patient with the symptoms and the ECG consistent with non-ST elevation ACS. ECG may be normal at times. Very often, there is ST segment depression. The patient may be in a non-PCI center or an ambulance or in a PCI center. Your attention immediately should be to the very high-risk patients, because those very high-risk patients go directly to the cath lab. In these diagrams, the green is a class 1 recommendation, the yellow is a class 2A, and the orange ones, as you'll see in a moment, are class 2B. The red, obviously, is a class 3 recommendation. But who are the non-ST elevation ACS patients who are at very high risk? Those patients who are hemodynamically unstable or indeed in cardiogenic shock with recurrent or ongoing chest pain, even refractory to medical management. Occasionally, these patients will have acute heart failure that is presumed to be secondary to ongoing myocardial ischemia. There may be life-threatening arrhythmias or even a cardiac arrest once the patient reaches hospital. There may be mechanical complications, and worry very much about recurrent dynamic ECG changes that are suggestive of ischemia. Those patients go right to the cath lab. Then their patients can either be high risk or not high risk. If they're high risk, you have the diagnosis, there's a high GRACE score, there may be transient ST elevation and dynamic repolarization changes. And for those patients, ideally, and remember this is now a class 2A recommendations, they should go to the cath lab for invasive management, ideally within the first 24 hours, but not necessarily so. And it really depends on the spectrum of high risk. And if the patients are not high risk, if they are at a non-PCI center, they should be transferred to a PCI center. And then for these patients, certainly they go to the cath lab to be evaluated for invasive management, but this is certainly not as rapid or as abrupt as the patients who are at high risk. And you see why, in looking at this management, we consider this as a spectrum. Now, what is the next thing? The next thing is the antithrombotic therapy, and that relates to anticoagulation. It relates to antiplatelet therapy and the choice of a P2Y12 inhibitor. And then what is it that you do over the long term? The STEMI patients, the class 1 recommendation is for unfractionated heparin, but you have certainly other options. The one thing that should not be used in the STEMI patients is fondaparinux. For the non-ST elevation, again, unfractionated heparin of choice. If the angiography is after 24 hours, this is the place for fondaparinux, and certainly an alternate, but not as ideal, enoxaparin. Now, what about the antiplatelet therapy? Certainly aspirin is a class 1. And then again, for the patients who are going for intervention, a P2Y12 inhibitor. Now, what about the choice of the P2Y12 inhibitor when you do invasive coronary angiography? Certainly, the ideal would be prasugrel or ticagrelor. If not available, then clopidogrel. And again, if the patient is proceeding to PCI, the prasugrel and to ticagrelor is really a class 2B. Now, later on, what is it that you do? Once you get beyond the acute period, and now you're looking at the time in months, aspirin plus a P2Y12 inhibitor should be considered for all patients. And beyond 12 months, aspirin alone. Now, remember that we closed our database in the spring. And subsequent to that, there were more new reports on P2Y12 inhibitor as the sole intervention. There were more presentations at ESC. There likely will be some at American Heart. And my guess is that this is one recommendation that will change with time. But at the time we looked at the data on solely P2Y12 inhibitors were not good enough to make it into the flow diagram. Now, obviously, we're concerned about bleeding. We're giving so many medications, and there may be a way to reduce the bleeding risk in the first 12 months after an acute coronary syndrome. There may be the possibility of abbreviated dual antiplatelet strategies, and only in high bleeding risk patients, not everybody, only in high bleeding risk patients, you may think about DAPT for 1 month and then the combination, and then either a P2Y12 inhibitor or aspirin monotherapy. In some high bleeding risk patients and in the non-high bleeding risk patients, there may be a choice of dual antiplatelet therapy for 3 months or 6 months, but certainly you need some medication, either a P2Y12 inhibitor or aspirin monotherapy, and we'll talk about up to 12 months. Now, there are ways to de-escalate the DAP therapy, and you may want to go to a less intense P2Y12 inhibitor, so change to clopidogrel, or aspirin and clopidogrel as your alternative. Now, what about the patient who presents with an acute coronary syndrome who has an indication for and obviously is likely to be on oral anticoagulants? So I think that there are several strategies, and certainly at least for the first week, triple therapy, oral anticoagulants and dual antiplatelet therapy for up to a week. And then you have a little bit of variability going from about a month to 6 months. Probably the advice is for dual antiplatelet therapy. And then after that, either dual antiplatelet therapy or possibly monotherapy with an oral anticoagulant, but that's a class 2B. And to me, a class 2B recommendation is think about it, but certainly no need to act on it. And then beyond 12 months, you can use the oral anticoagulant monotherapy as a class 1 indication. Now, in some patients, because of incomplete revascularization, you're worried about ischemic risk. And in those patients, and this is not a class 1 recommendation, you may want to consider triple therapy, the oral anticoagulants and DAPT for up to a month, and then follow the same routine that we did for the patients where you're not worried about ischemic risk. Now, what about intravascular imaging? I'm not going to spend much time on this, There's a large section there for my interventional colleagues. But basically, if there's a clear culprit lesion suitable for PCI, there is a recommendation to think about intravascular imaging to guide PCI, but it is not a class one recommendation to do PCI of the culprit lesion. If there's not a clear culprit lesion, and this is a 2B recommendation, which means think about it, intravascular imaging, and then treat based on the results of the intravascular imaging. Now, what do you do for the patient with multivessel coronary disease? So here we have the patient with an acute coronary syndrome who is undergoing percutaneous intervention of the culprit lesion and who has angiographically significant stenosis in the non-IRA. If the patient is in cardiogenic shock, remember we talked about stable versus unstable. This is the unstable patient. So the immediate PCI only of the IRA, and then consider staged complete revascularization once the patient has stabilized. In STEMI, the recommendation for is as complete revascularization as can be accomplished either during the index procedure or within the next month or so. In the non-ST elevation ACS, complete revascularization is really a class 2A recommendation, and possibly think to evaluate the non-culprit lesion. But basically, the STEMI, you're aiming for complete revascularization, cardiogenic shock only initially, the culprit lesion, and the NST-ACS, depending on the stability or the risk status of the patient. Now, what about long-term treatment? Because we spend so much time in ACS, but the patient is going to be living with this ACS, we hope, for many, many years. And we really want to discharge them on a cardioprotective medication and do lifestyle management and referral to cardiac rehab, and then arrange in the outpatient setting to address all of the comorbidities. And we will talk about patient goals and patient preference. But what we want to do is three things: to support a healthy lifestyle, to continue optimal pharmacologic management, and then really to look at the treatment of risk factors. So smoking cessation, healthy diet, regular exercise, healthy weight, certainly psychosocial issues deserve attention. In terms of the risk factors, we talk about antithrombotic drugs, we talk about lipid-lowering drugs, we talk about annual influenza vaccine, and then here we really talk about what is it that we're going to do to be sure that the patients adhere to their regimen, and then other treatments that I'll discuss in a moment as appropriate. The goal for blood pressure is a systolic pressure 120 over 80. The LDL goal here is 50 and a hemoglobin A1C under 7%. So these are the goals of therapy long-term. And we'll talk about some of the newer recommendations for what you and I may do in hospital as well. Now, this is new to this guideline, and it addresses a patient-centered approach to their ACS journey. And this is before the patient comes to hospital, when you're seeing a patient who is at risk, who may have had a prior episode, who may have risk factors, You have to consider all the risk factors, establish the medical history and the medication history, but also consider psychosocial factors. We've not been good enough doing this over time. At hospital admission, you have to individualize care at triage, and I've given you the variables there. And then a person-centered clinical assessment, and then shared decision-making. Now, this is hard in an emergency or urgent setting, but we have to learn how to do this to have the patient involved. And then preparing for discharge, we have to work with the team to explain what the long-term treatment is, what the treatment is, why it is important, educate about lifestyle medication modification, and consider both emotional and mental health. Again, we've not put that in the guidelines before, but more and more we're seeing how important that is. And then what is it that our ACS patients expect? And essentially, as the clinician, you're the project manager for this team. And what is it that you should see that the team does? The patient should expect that their ACS symptoms are recognized. They should expect high quality, effective, and safe care, and the right care at the right time. And we talked about the right time. Patients should expect that their physical, mental, and emotional well-being are considered, that the information provided them is clear and comprehensible, and that there is shared decision-making that respects their preference. Consideration and support for their family and their caregivers, attention to both their physical and environmental disease, and we have to see that they have a clean and a safe hospital environment. That is also in our wheelhouse. Now, in the last few minutes, I want to go over some of the new recommendations, things that were not in previous guidelines, either the STEMI or the NSTEMI, and they cover a whole variety of areas, and I'm going to go through them briefly. It's antiplatelet, anticoagulant, cardiac arrest, invasive strategies, multivessel disease, multivariate disease, and then complications, comorbidities, long-term management, and patient perspectives. And we're using the same class of recommendations. Class one, those are in green, recommended or as indicated. Class two, where there's some divergent of opinion. 2A, it should be considered. That's closer to a one. Class 2B may be considered. Just think about it. It means a little bit of evidence has poked its head and you have to decide how you're going to use it. But very important is class three, where this is not recommended because either it is no benefit or there may be harm. And then the level of evidence is very much as we use in the US, A, data derived from multiple RCTs or meta-analysis, B, data from a single randomized trial or large non-randomized studies, and C is either consensus of the experts or small studies or retrospective studies or registries. So there really is difference in many of these in the level of evidence. And for many of the recommendations, we will never get a level A recommendation. Now, let me go through these. And these are the recommendations. And we'll go through the class. And if the patient with an ACS undergoes coronary artery bypass grafting, obviously the DAPT is stopped during the procedure. It's recommended that they resume DAPT for at least 12 months, and that's the level one recommendation. And we have to see that our surgical colleagues have this order as the patient is discharged from hospital. And then in older patients, particularly those with high bleeding risk, consider clopidogrel, perhaps the less potent P2Y12 inhibitor. There's just a little bit of evidence that, but again, an older patient at high bleeding risk. And what about alternative antithrombotic regimens? If the patient is event-free after 3 to 6 months of DAPT, they're not at high ischemic risk, single antiplatelet therapy should be considered, and preferably with a P2Y12 inhibitor. That's a two-way recommendation. My guess is that's going to improve at a level of recommendation as the newer studies appear. And again, P2Y12 monotherapy may be considered as an alternative to aspirin for long-term treatment. At the time of the guideline, the data were not as strong as I think they are now, but this is what the guideline says. Now, what about patients at high bleeding risk? Monotherapy, either aspirin or P2Y12, may be considered after 1 month of DAPT. But remember, this is a 2B recommendation. Just think about it and think about it in relationship to what you think the high bleeding risk is. In the patients requiring oral anticoagulant, you may withdraw antiplatelet therapy at 6 months rather than at a year, a 2B recommendation. But de-escalation of antiplatelet therapy in the first 30 days after an ACS, not recommended. That puts the patient at risk. And then what about cardiac arrest and out-of-hospital cardiac arrest? Neuroprognosis should be evaluated no earlier than 72 hours after an admission in all comatose survivors after a cardiac arrest. But note that this is no earlier than 72 hours. And this, I think, really applies more to Europe than to the US. A patient with an out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, send them to a cardiac arrest center. We don't have cardiac arrest centers particularly, but many areas in Europe do. So that's more relevant to my European colleagues. Then what about technical aspects of invasive strategies? And some of these are important. The patient with SCAD, PCI recommended only if there are symptoms and ongoing ischemia and lots of myocardium in jeopardy. Because remember, that lesion heals. If there is a stent placed and the lesion heals, the stent is not in apposition to the vascular wall. You really want to try to avoid stenting unless that patient has ongoing myocardial ischemia or much myocardium in jeopardy. Think about intravascular imaging to guide PCI. That's a level 2A, and we may see more and more of this. But considering OCT for patients with an ambiguous culprit lesion, it's a 2B, just think about it. Now, patients who present in cardiogenic shock, stage PCI of a non-infarct-related artery should be considered. That's a pretty good recommendation. And then recommendations for multivessel disease in the STEMI patient who is very hemodynamically stable, undergoing primary PCI. Non-IRA should be open depending on angiographic severity, and that's a class one recommendation, but do not do epicardial functional assessment of the non-culprit segment, not during the index procedure. Now, what about the complications of acute coronary syndrome? And these have not been addressed in previous guidelines, and some of these have, have reasonable levels of evidence. Here is the patient who has an ACS, who has high degree AV block that does not resolve within at least 5 days following the myocardial infarction. Class one recommendation for implantation of a permanent pacemaker before the patient goes home. Consider MRI, 2A recommendations, if there is equivocal echo or clinical suspicion of an LV thrombus. You really want to know if that LV thrombus is there. And then following an acute anterior MI, contrast echo may be considered if the LV thrombus is not well visualized. A little bit of evidence for that. And now this is interesting, just a little bit of evidence, but I think look for future studies on this. Selected patients, high degree AV block, anterior wall MI, and acute heart failure. You may consider early device implantation with cardiac resynchronization, defibrillator pacemaker. I think this is an area where we are not sure what to do, but think about it. And then recurrent life-threatening ventricular arrhythmias, sedation or general anesthesia, a possibility. Think about it. Now, what about comorbidities? Because we really have not addressed that well enough in the setting of acute coronary syndromes. What about the choice of long-term glucose-lowering treatment? The recommendation is that the decision for the choice is based on comorbidities that include heart failure, chronic kidney disease, and obesity. And we have a whole variety of therapies, but these are the three variables that make your decision. And then for frail older patients with comorbidities, as you look at interventional and pharmacologic therapies, evaluate each one of them for the risks and benefit. And this is the area for shared decision-making. Now, what about cancer patients? We're seeing more and more cancer patients in the ACS setting, and we've not given good guidance in our guidelines. And surprisingly, there is rather good evidence in the literature. Cancer patients with a high-risk ACS who have an expected survival of more than 6 months, class one recommendation for an invasive strategy. Another thing, interruption of cancer therapy in patients in whom the therapy is suspected to contribute to the ACS, possible checkpoint inhibitors, et cetera. And then a conservative, non-invasive strategy should be considered when there is a poor cancer prognosis, expected survival less than 6 months, or a very high bleeding risk. So here is where you may really not be as aggressive as you would in the patient who has a good cancer prognosis. And then again, in the cancer patients, very important, level three, do not use. No aspirin if the platelet count is under 10,000. No clopidogrel if the platelet count is under 30,000. And no prasugrel or ticagrelor if the platelet count is under 50,000. So good evidence and good guidance as to what you do depending on the patients who have low platelet counts. Now, what about long-term management? Recommended to intensify lipid-lowering therapy during the index ACS hospitalization for patients who are on therapy before, which means they go on to a high-dose statin. And then low-dose colchicine, a 2B recommendation. Think about it. Evidence there, but weak. And then combination therapy with a high-dose statin and ezetimibe may be even considered during the index hospitalization, but a 2B recommendation. And then what about patient perspectives? Patient-centered care recommended by assessing and adhering to individual patient preferences, needs, and beliefs so that patient values inform all clinical decisions. And that is a class one recommendation. Include ACS patients in decision-making as much as you can, but inform them about adverse effects, radiation exposure, alternative options. And there are a number of decision aids that our European colleagues use that facilitate that discussion. And they are detailed in the document, and that is a class one recommendation. And then assess symptoms using methods that help patients describe their experience. And there are specific aids that can be used. And then this teach back technique for informed consent. There may be some evidence to do that. We've not used that much in the States. In Europe, it is part of their standard procedure with the 2A recommendation. And then adequate discharge information, written and verbal, and prepare the patient using teach back technique and motivational interviewing, a 2A recommendation, and then assessment of mental well-being using a validated tool, a 2A recommendation. Covered a lot of territory. Let me try to summarize, because this is what we should do in the spectrum of ACS, realizing that it goes from unstable angina to NSTEMI to STEMI. And these are the things that I want you to think about. There are five things. Think ACS at the initial assessment. Think that the ECG, is it abnormal? Think about the clinical context. Think about the stability of the patient. And then think invasive management. Basically, with a STEMI, preferable for primary PCI, fibrinolysis of PCI not available. For the very high-risk NSTACS, get to the lab as soon as possible. The high-risk early, but not that immediate. Then thinking antithrombotic therapy, aspirin, a P2Y12 inhibitor, and anticoagulation, depending on the setting, either unfractionated heparin, low molecular weight heparin, bivalirudin, fondaparinux. Then, importantly, think revascularization, PCI or CABG based on patient characteristics, aiming for complete revascularization, and really consider adjunctive tests to guide the complete revascularization. And then finally, the last think is think secondary prevention. Think about the antithrombotic drugs, about the lipid lowering drugs, smoking cessation, cardiac rehab, risk factor management, and psychosocial considerations. This is a fairly complex scheme, but if you follow through and do the thinking, ACS, invasive management, antithrombotic therapy, revascularization, and secondary prevention, then I think you will give the patient the best chance to succeed at surviving an ACS. And I thank you for your attention.
First of all, incredible presentation, such a comprehensive guideline, and clearly advancing our thoughts in the field. I have several questions, but I'm just going to ask one. Several times you referenced PCI centers, especially related to ACS management. In our country, every center around the block is a PCI center. Is there data, even in cities like London, a large health system picks one center out of all their hospitals to be their PCI ACS center, and that's staffed 24/7, ready to go. Is there data to support better outcomes with those type of strategies versus, you know, how we approach it in our country, where each and every hospital becomes its own PCI ACS center?
You know, see, I think, Dr. Sperling, that what we're doing is we're thinking of urban rather than rural. And when we think of rural America, there is not a PCI center around every corner, so that there are centers where they do fibrinolysis and then the system is for transfer. But the European system will vary from one country to another. Some of the countries have their PCI centers. If they're close in an urban center, they'll be center A will do it Monday, center B will do it Tuesday, et cetera, so that they have their influx of patients, they're highly staffed, and then they have the whole week to ease up. There is really no way to compare because the patient population coming in differs so much and the strategies differ so much. In London, some of the centers will be designated a center, and it's where the ambulances go. It's where I think our urban centers were 5 or 6 years ago, where not every center had 24 and 7 PCI. But PCI, I think, in urban America is fairly ubiquitous. And again, if you're going to compare outcomes, you really have to compare what goes in to the mix. And that will vary very much with the patient population that's being served.
And then that was great. So I was reminded of a long time ago when you like assigned me the topic of which questions came up about how long do you have bed rest after an acute MI, and just shows how far we have come since back then at Grady. And a comment about what Larry was talking about was that I think in Georgia, we've done a very good job with having PCI centers really scattered around. And most patients with acute MIs nowadays in this state, it seems to me, get reasonably rapid intervention. And I don't know about other states. I think it's similar throughout the country, but I think Georgia's done a really good job with that. And it seems to me, and you give me your ideas about this, that in the last umpteen years, that STEMI somehow has fallen off a bit. And the patients that we get in that need balloon pumps and transplants, that number has fallen off a little bit. And I often wonder why that is. And I think it's because all the things that we've done, it's a conglomeration of like statin therapy, our emphasis on healthy lifestyle, acute intervention, coronary bypass surgery, the sum total of that seems to me has caused the instance of acute STEMI, for which we lose a lot of myocardium. Seems to me that's fallen off. What is your perspective on that?
I expect that some of the prevention that we've done, even though it's far from optimal, has helped the progression of disease. But I think we've also become more adept at recognizing the end STEMIs, where many of them may have just stayed home and managed to survive, and we see them later on, either doing very well or having wall motion abnormalities. But now we really have the challenge of this triad of very high-risk end STEMIs, high-risk end STEMIs, and then the ones that are going to do well no matter what we do or don't do with them. So that really is the area of challenge for us. But again, I think that where we have fallen behind is public education. Because remember the delay chart that I showed you. And even if we have the EMS system finely tuned and the patient who has a STEMI goes right to the lab, the delay is the patient either getting to the center or calling EMS. And the small amount of data that I know where we have surveyed has been the signs and warning signs and symptoms of a heart attack in women. And when we started the campaign of the Heart Truth campaign and the Go Red, we had about half of the women aware that heart disease was their major cause of mortality, and they knew the signs and symptoms. As we redid the survey just a few years ago, we have totally lost all of those gains. And the majority of women do not know signs and symptoms of a heart attack, and that lack of knowledge is greatest among the women at highest risk, and that is the young women and the women of racial and ethnic minorities. That same survey has not been done in men, but I expect it's similar. So perhaps our challenge is to have the patient delay component improved the way we've improved the EMS system in Georgia.
First of all, Steve, I mean, I think the data are quite striking that there's a huge reduction in STEMI over the last 30 years, right? I mean, it's down, you know, dramatically, and whether that's public health, smoking decreases in the U.S. or statins or whatever, we can debate. My question for you, Nanette, is where did beta blockers end up in these recommendations for the STEMI patients? I didn't hear those mentioned, and is that, you know, particularly the debate on duration of beta blocker therapy after STEMI?
Say it again.
So beta blockers in STEMI patients, right? We typically would give a beta blocker in a STEMI patient. And I didn't see that pop up in the recommendations, particularly duration of therapy after STEMI.
The data on beta blockers are not as strong as they were early on when we didn't have all of the other therapies. It's addressed in the text. It's recommended early on. Duration, there really are no good data to recommend it. But so many of these patients have comorbidities that beta blockers may be able to address ventricular dysfunction, hypertension, et cetera. And in the ACS patient, my early choice for those is a beta blocker, because remember, it's an antiarrhythmic agent as well.
Thank you, Dr. Wenger. There's a question from Dr. Smith that I can go ahead and read in the chat. As a secondary CAD prevention strategy, are we overusing aspirin in patients on anticoagulation for atrial fibrillation?
Well, again, the recommendations that were given is that certainly early on, the patient who was anticoagulated for atrial fibrillation, you should be using at least triple therapy for at least the first week, and then you can de-escalate the therapy, but the long-term therapy should be solely oral anticoagulation, either with Coumadin or with a DOAC.
One other thought is always get concerned about an ACS caused by circumflex occlusion. And the patient who comes in the emergency room with mild elevation of enzymes and ST segment depression, somehow they don't get the rapid assessment and treatment that the ST segment elevation does. You know, when the circumflex is occluded, that gives you this true posterior looking EKG, and it doesn't catch the eye of the emergency room physician. And the circumflex, of course, is really important. It has papillary muscle responsibilities, and I have been caught in those situations before when I've like say, okay, let's go to the cath lab, and you get some sort of hesitancy with that when a large circumflex is occluded and they're about to wipe out their posterior lateral wall. Was that mentioned in these guidelines, or did you all discuss that?
We really didn't get into the weeds on this area, but again, the one thing that we emphasize throughout the guidelines is the ECG, and it is a 12-lead ECG, and we should be looking at all 12 leads to see what the ECG changes are. And sometimes looking at all 12 leads, you will see the elevation that may be missed as people look at the reciprocal depression in the other leads.
Okay, great. Well, we are past 8:30. Thank you, Dr. Wenger, for that very comprehensive talk and for getting us up to speed on the guidelines. Thank you.
The preceding program is copyrighted by Emory University.